Discover the latest health tips, expert advice, and inspiring stories. This is the Health Channel Podcast. Your journey to better health starts now.
When school started, you managed to get your big kids off the couch and into the classroom. But I'm sure there are many of you families with young kids that are going to go to daycare for the very first time. And I'm sure you have tons of questions about how to get them prepared, how to transition them into school. On the next episode of Ask the Doc, I'll address some of your concerns about transitioning into daycare and keeping your kids safe and healthy during this new school year on Ask the Doc. Welcome to Ask the Doc. I am Dr. Scarlet Constant, founder of Constant Care Pediatrics. This show is a show where we encourage you viewers to send in your questions or concerns, and I will answer them in real time. Let's start with our first question that's coming in now from Facebook. This question is from Philip. Hi, Dr. Constant. Our three kids are excited about getting back to school, but what can we do to make sure they get enough sleep? My wife and I both work, and we want to spend more time with them when we get home, but that means a later bedtime. Do you have any guidelines about how much sleep they need? Well, Philip, that's a great question, and all of us are in the same boat. You know, in this day and age, many of us either work much later or we work from home, which means truly work never ends. But then we have the ongoing battle of wanting to spend time with our children. And this is very difficult. And my guideline to you is that you really need to set a balance for what works for you and your wife. So if a later bedtime means you get to spend more quality time with your children, then you should definitely push it, but obviously not too late. I suggest that your children, school-aged children, younger than about 15 years of age, they should get at least 10 to 12 hours of sleep at night. As your children get older and approach the adolescent years, then 8 to 10 hours of sleep overnight is more than adequate. So I think that as a family, you guys should think about the schedule and try to create a structure and a schedule that works best for all of you so that you can enjoy each other and get a great night's sleep. Good luck, Philip. Our next question is coming in from the All Health TV app. Ramona wants to know, Doctor, I'm very worried about my little kindergarten girl. She's only 5 years old, but she has a backpack that is huge for her size. I mean, it's ridiculously big and heavy, too. She's in kindergarten. I'm concerned that it's going to hurt her back, arms, and leg muscles. Well, Ramona, I'm sorry to hear that. The first thing I would want to ask is what is in her backpack? I'm assuming for kindergarten, she doesn't bring books to school, nor does she bring any work home from school. So if she's really not transporting much, why don't you just decrease the size of her backpack and give her something that works for her body type? There's really no need to overexert her or put anything that's just too big or too heavy. Something that's comfortable on her back and that is weight appropriate is what you should send her to school in. And if you have any concerns, you should definitely speak to her teacher and find out what they suggest. Good luck. Okay, seems like we have another question coming in. This question is from Daryl. Our 2-year-old boy is in daycare and he's happy there, but the kid is always getting sick. And when he comes home with a cold or a virus, the rest of us always come down with it too. We expect him to pick up germs at school, but what can we do to protect ourselves? I've already had to take time off of work because I had the flu 2 weeks ago, 2 weeks after Aiden got it at school. Well, Daryl, that sounds miserable. I have a couple of suggestions. First of all, you want to make sure that when your kid comes home from school, he takes off his clothes, washes his hands, or even just takes a shower right away. You want to make sure that everybody in the house is up to date on their vaccines, especially the flu vaccine. In the fall, the flu and COVID usually have a surge because everybody's coming back from vacations and going back to school. And so you want to make sure that everybody's up to date with their vaccine so that they can, in fact, battle this illness. This is not to say that you can't catch the flu or that you can't catch COVID, but you can absolutely get through it a lot easier without some of the concerns that you had before and without having to miss so much work. So I would say to keep up with your vaccines, wash your hands, have your child take a shower when he comes home, and make sure that everybody is eating well and getting adequate sleep so that their immune system is up and running well. Looks like we have another question coming in. And this question is from Wilma. I know you're going to roll your eyes, doctor, when you read this, especially if you have children too. But is there anything I can do to encourage our children to eat healthy snacks at school? We're pretty strict about what we bring into our house, but at school, the kids eat junk food whenever they can get it. Any advice? Well, Wilma, I would never roll my eyes at your question, as I'm a pediatrician and I'm here to answer all of your questions and to guide you the best way that I can. I don't think there's any such thing as a stupid question. And actually, it is quite difficult with the kids if you are providing a certain type of environment at home, but then they go to school and they're finding all the junk food and bad snacks. The best advice I can give you is to really educate your children. Not only are you providing good snacks at home, but talk to them about these snacks and explain to them why it is so important that they eat well and make healthy choices so that when they're faced with them at school, hopefully they'll be able to make the right decision. I also think it's important for you to let your kids know that it's okay to cheat every once in a while. Sometimes you're not going to be able to resist the junk food that's offered, but if you know that they're doing a great job at home and eating well on the weekends, maybe cheating here and there is okay. It is important to eat as a family and show them how to make the right choices and to eat well. And hopefully they'll take that with them when they go to school and say kindly decline the junk food that is put in front of them or offer to them. It looks like we have another question coming in, and that's from Facebook, and it's from Renee. Hi, Dr. Constant. My girls ages 7 and 9 are up to date with their vaccinations, and most of the time they're pretty healthy, but they never wash their hands on their own. I always have to remind them to wash with soap and water before meals, when they come home from school, and when they come in from playing with other kids. How can we encourage them to help fight germs by washing their hands? You know, this is an ongoing battle, and your kids are pretty young. 7 and 9 is a fair age to have to remind them constantly to do the things that they should do, like washing their hands, brushing their teeth, and sometimes even going potty. So I think that that's fine that you constantly have to remind them. It doesn't mean that they don't want to or they don't understand it. It just means that they get distracted. I think it's also fun if you want to include a really nice activity at home, which I'm sure many of you have seen before, where you put the dish soap in water, and then you add salt and pepper, and then you have your children put their hands in it to see what happens when they have germs in their hands and they can watch it disperse. It's a really cool experiment. You can look it up, but that just teaches our children how many germs they actually have on their hands and what happens if they do not wash their hands. So that's a fun experiment. Maybe if they can conceptualize how dirty their hands actually are, then they'll be more inclined to wash them. So good luck. I hope that that helps. So the next question is coming in from Facebook, and it's from Khalid. Hi, I really need some advice about how to deal with anxiety in my daughter, who's in second grade. We joke about saying she's 8 going on 18, but she gets herself so worked up about what she's going to wear to school, her homework, her friends, the other kids in class, and her tennis game. How can we help her? Well, Khalid, I'm glad that you're really trying to get ahead of this and try to figure out how you can help her before it becomes something that inhibits her normal lifestyle. I would say the first concern is, you know, how much does this anxiety come into play with her day-to-day activity? If she's worried about things in a healthy, almost healthy way, that's fine. It's normal to be worried about something because she actually cares. She's working hard. She wants to look good. She wants to play well in her tennis game. And being worried or preoccupied is absolutely normal. Now, if she's so anxious that it gets in the way of what she's trying to execute, or she can't actually perform well at school, or she chokes at a tennis match, or has anxiety or phobia about going to school because she doesn't think that she'll be accepted and her anxiety is taking over, that is a whole different concern where I would absolutely consult your pediatrician about that. But for her to just to be an 8-year-old that's actually concerned about things and seems to be taking things seriously in her life, I think that that's okay. Again, if you are concerned and it seems like something that's really keeping her up at night, getting in the way of her friendships, getting in the way with your relationship with her, you should absolutely consult your pediatrician to discuss it further and to explore further if there's anything else going on. I hope that this answer helps you. The next question is coming in now online. This is from Mary Louise. I have a 3-year-old in daycare and a 10-month-old at home. Without fail, whenever my toddler comes home with a runny nose or cough, the baby gets it, and it lasts longer in her. There's no way I can separate them. What can I do? Yes, Mary Louise, this is probably the worst situation because the 10-month-old is essentially a sitting duck and waiting for your toddler to come home and bring all her germs into the house. So as I mentioned in the previous question to the other caller, it's definitely important for your 3-year-old to come in, wash their hands, take off their clothes, either take a shower or put on another set of clothes before they touch their sibling, play with them, carry them. And this is important for you as well. A lot of times we can be the vectors of transmission between our older and our younger child. So when you pick up your 3-year-old from school or interact with your 3-year-old, you too need to wash your hands. Or maybe if you were at school that day visiting and or participating in an activity, when you do come home, you want to change your clothes, wash your hands before touching the 10-month-old. There's not much to do with the 10-month-old as far as protection, aside from keeping the 10-month-old up to date with vaccines. And again, making sure your 10-month-old also has the flu vaccine that's offered in ages 6 months and up. So if your 10-month-old is vaccinated, is protected against the flu, is eating a full meal, regular full meals, because at this point they're on a solid food diet, they're getting adequate sleep, they should have a robust immune system in order to combat the viruses that they're toddler sibling is bringing home. And then just remember that you and other caregivers can also transmit illnesses between your 2 children. So please make sure to practice all of the precautions that I mentioned for your toddler. So it seems that everybody has a lot of questions about starting daycare and protecting those at home and not circulating illnesses. And I will say it is frustrating when you have back-to-back viruses, but this is a moment that will pass. This is just the body's way of really getting used to, getting exposed to viruses, getting used to them, and then fighting them off better and stronger and faster later on. So please try to be patient and don't worry. Your child will not continue to get sick every single year of school indefinitely. It does get better. Okay, it looks like we have a question coming in from the All Health TV app. This question is coming in from Reed. Hey, Doc, my young son has been in school for 1.5 years, which means I've been sick for 1.5 years. Anything I can do to keep away the daycare crud? Well, Reed, like I mentioned before, it is really tough. You want to make sure that your kid is getting good sleep, is eating well, is overall healthy. I know it's really tough to ask your young toddlers not to put their fingers in their mouth, but believe it or not, most of these viruses are transmitted by oral transmission. So we really don't want nail biting, sucking the thumb. Also, some people still send their kids to school with pacifiers. Remember, pacifier is another route of transmission. The pacifier drops on the floor, their dirty hands touch it, they take it in and out of their mouth and pass it along. So let's try to minimize putting anything in their mouth, pacifiers, fingers, anything that's going to transmit those viruses. It's really important. And if we can do that, we can keep the viruses out of the home. I hope that helps, Reed. Good luck. The next question is coming in from the All Health TV app. And this question is coming in from Trent. Hello, Dr. Constant. My wife, Suzette, and I are a little concerned about our boy, Trent Jr., also known as TJ. This poor kid keeps coming home from daycare with diarrhea, and we're not sure what's causing it. Could it be a bug he's picking up at daycare, or maybe something like lactose intolerance? We'd love your thoughts. Well, yes, Trent, absolutely he could be picking something up at school. Acute gastroenteritis is a very common viral illness that's passed around the daycare. And to add to what I was mentioning before, it's passed by the oral, it's called a fecal-oral transmission. So that you can imagine the kids are putting their hands in their mouth and putting their hands in other places that they shouldn't. They're not washing their hands or cleaning them, and then they're passing the virus back and forth. Viral gastroenteritis spreads so quickly throughout the daycare. Sometimes you'll see a kid leave school because they're sick, and by the time they come back to school because they're feeling better, the viral gastroenteritis has had time to go all the way around and back again to the kid, the same kid that started it. So needless to say, this is an infection that really needs to be contained right away. Now, not all diarrhea can be attributed to acute viral gastroenteritis. So please, if you feel that there's something else going on with your child, or maybe they've had it too many times to seem normal, or maybe your child has diarrhea and nobody else in the class has it, you really need to speak to your pediatrician about this so they can explore other differential diagnoses for the diarrhea. Yes, lactose intolerance could be a reason, but there are many other reasons, such as a bacterial diarrhea, an infection, or a milk protein intolerance, or maybe there's overexposure to fruits and sugars. Believe it or not, there's something called osmotic diarrhea, where if you ingest too much sugar, then you would have just an increase in liquid in your and diarrheal stools. So there are many reasons for toddlers to develop diarrhea. And especially if it's recurrent, I suggest that you consult your pediatrician right away in order to explore it further. Okay, it looks like we have another question incoming from Facebook. This is from Fred. Hi, Dr. Constant. What should parents look for in a daycare's policies regarding sick children and illness management? That's a great question, Fred. And, you know, it's so important because when we were in the middle of the pandemic, daycares had really strict rules and regulations about being sick, about exposure, about returning to school. And I will tell you that I saw firsthand from being a pediatrician in the community that this decreased the spread of not only COVID, but all common daycare viruses tremendously. There was a huge drop in RSV, in flu, ear infections, hand, foot, mouth, diarrhea. And this was because there were strict rules about bringing your child to school with symptoms or being sick. So you should absolutely ask, how long does a child have to stay out if they had a fever? When can a child come back if they were diagnosed with an illness? What type of documentation does the school require in order for the child to return back to school? What symptoms would they need to see in a child to send that child home? And most importantly, What precautionary measures are they using in the daycare, and what type of cleaning, what is the cleaning protocol in the daycare if a child had a diagnosed illness or symptoms within the daycare? How often are they cleaning the daycare? These are all very important questions, and it's fair to ask these questions when interviewing daycare centers and selecting a daycare for your child. I think the most important thing to look for is a daycare that will not allow a child to return to school within the same 24 hours of a fever, and a daycare that will not allow a child to come to school that is symptomatic. And I think that these are important questions that you need to ask, and in order for you to consider where you're going to put your child, this will make a huge impact on how often your child is catching an illness and bringing it home. Good luck finding the right place for your child. Looks like we have another question coming in. This question is from Bethann. Hi, Doc. What kind of safety protocols should be in place for outdoor playtime at daycare centers? Well, Bethann, I think that it's important. I think the most important thing is to ask the daycare what the teacher to student ratio is outside. You should have a very healthy teacher or teaching aide to student ratio. You want to make sure that the games outside or the jungle gym and things like that are actually age appropriate. They also should have a protocol in place if a child falls. You know, who do they contact first? How do they manage the fall? Do they have incident reports as far as getting cut or scratches or, you know, lacerations? You want to make sure that that they have some type of protocol where they either have a first aid kit and they call the parent, or, you know, maybe they call the parent first. So you really want to know what they have in place, but they should have a first aid. They should have direct communication with parents. They should have a healthy teacher-student protocol, and they should make sure that all of the playground tools are age appropriate and actually approved, and make sure that they're approved by coding so that the children don't get hurt. So I hope that that helps. I know that choosing a daycare can be very difficult, and there's just so much to look into. But, you know, I hope that this helped you with the process. You know, the most important thing to do is make sure, number one, you have a place that really takes illnesses seriously, and they look at the viral symptoms of a child, and they send kids home if they are sick, and they're not too hard on families that pull their children out of school. Sometimes families are reluctant to take their kids out of daycare because they're penalized by the daycare. So I think it's really great to make sure that that it's a flexible policy where the school encourages you to stay home if your child is sick or if your child is symptomatic. They encourage you to stay home if you've had a fever within 24 hours, and hopefully want you to be seen by a physician before you get back to the daycare. You want a center that is clean that is actually cleaning up every day and making sure that they have the right cleaning materials to combat bacteria and viruses. You also want to make sure that your children are practicing these protocols. They're washing their hands or taking off their clothes after they come home from school. You want to make sure that your children are up to date with their vaccinations. They're getting their annual flu vaccine, which is so important, and that they're eating well and getting adequate sleep so that they have a robust immune system. Another thing that's really important is just to remember how transmissible bacteria and viruses are when you are in school, especially the lower school. I don't really want to focus on daycare, but lower school up to kindergarten, first grade, because this is where we have a lot of interaction with kids touching each other, holding hands, sharing toys, putting their hands in their mouth, and then touching something else in the classroom. Those are all ways that you can transmit hand, foot, mouth, impetigo. You could transmit RSV. All of these viruses are, and the flu, of course, they're transmitted within these lower schools a lot more frequently than they are in the upper level due to the constant contact. A lot of parents have asked me about impetigo, and actually starting school, we see a lot of impetigo. That's usually caused by, especially here in Miami, it's caused by staph infection. So basically what happens is your child is scratching their skin, probably from mosquito bites, or they get a little cut from playing in the playground. And then the staph that we all typically have in our skin and under our nails and in our nose gets transmitted into the bloodstream, causing a staph infection, or it gets transmitted into the skin cells, causing what we call staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome or impetigo. So you get really bad blisters that are itchy and quite contagious and need to be treated by antibiotics. This is another example of the scratching and touching and rubbing that causes transmittable diseases throughout the younger age groups. And we really need to get ahead of that before it spreads to all of the kids in the class or maybe worsening in the body. So these things are important to look out for. And again, this is why we have to reiterate to our children that they have to cut their nails short. We have to wash our hands, keep our hands out of our mouth. Of course, they're going to touch their friends, but we want to make sure that they wash their hands before they eat, wash their hands after the bathroom to not transmit these illnesses. And we want to make sure that the school is cleaning up appropriately so that they're not getting it from the desks or surfaces. Specific to us here in Miami, another way to prevent something like impetigo or staph is make sure you're putting bug repellent on your kids, because once they get those big mosquito bites, the one thing that you can be certain they're going to do is scratch and scratch and scratch until they cut up some blisters on their legs. So bug repellent is very important when you're sending your little ones to school. I say the little ones because those are the ones that are going to get a lot of playground time. Not only do they have recess, but they have playground time. So they're the most exposed to bugs and mosquitoes. So you really want to protect them. That was a lot of information about going back to school and how to transition your toddlers into daycare, and what we're looking for in a daycare. I hope that it was helpful, but I really just wanted to make sure that you understand what is waiting for you when you're transitioning into school for the first time. And I want you to remember that it does pass. This is just kind of a shock to the immune system in the beginning, but your kids will get stronger and their defense system will be more robust. And this will not be a problem, usually past the age of around 4. So good luck and have a great day.
Thank you for listening to the Health Channel podcast. We hope this information has been useful. However, please remember that only your doctor can advise you about what is best for you. Do not start, modify, or suspend treatment based on anything you have heard on this podcast. Please join us again soon.